Here we go. So if you are new, which I don't think any of you are, most of you have been here for at least a few sessions. So I am Susan Tuttle, CEO of Terra Pinagrada. I'm a Prince II accredited trainer. And since COVID-19, I've had just a stop in business for a while. So there's nothing really scheduled for the next month and a half. I have a bunch of resources on my website. So again, please feel free to use those. They're readily available. All right. I've muted everybody's microphone, but if you have any questions, we'll use chat function and we'll have a bit of time at the end to do that. Or again, there's not that many of us. We could use our microphones as well. My assumptions, you know, something about projects, project management, and a bit about Prince II. And we only have 40 minutes, so we've got to get going with this. We're going to talk just a tiny bit about some key concepts about processes, but then we're going to spend the whole time talking about the Prince II life cycle. We'll see all seven processes in action from start to finish. And then we can look at tailoring. How do we tailor this for small projects and large projects, or when you're part of a program? Finish up with questions. So just to clarify what a process even is. It's just a series of actions or steps taken in order to achieve a particular end. And a good process is like a checklist that ensures the right things are getting done by the right people at the right time. So that's what you can think about. These are a set of activities and you use them as a checklist to make sure you're doing these activities. And the benefits of having processes is that you have consistency. So that's why we're proposing these seven processes in the first place. We want consistency in your projects. It also gives you a lot of visibility. So when people are asking you about your project, they say, where are you? We're at the beginning, so we're using these processes. Or we're in the middle, we're using these processes. At the end, using these processes. So it gives you lots of visibility of what you're doing and why you're doing it. It also could just be for compliance. You need to have a set of processes. And if you have processes, it gives you a good opportunity to improve. If something's not working, you can amend your processes. Again, we're offering seven processes. These are going to help you consistently manage your projects from start to finish. Some you only do at the beginning, some you use repeatedly in the middle, and others just at the end. So here's the high-level overview of what it all looks like from start to finish. We're going to start at the beginning and work our way through to the end. But this is the overall picture of a Prince II project. Now I'm going to be covering, 75 to 80% of what's going on in these processes. If I covered 100% of it, it would take a lot longer than 40 minutes. So I've had to cut some things down, but I'm hitting the main points of these processes. What are the key things you're thinking about in these? So this is a high-level overview. All right, so we're going to start, and every project starts with an idea. So you have to have an idea to do something, and we're presented with this idea in something called a project mandate. If you're really, really lucky, this thing is written down, so you're getting a document documenting this idea for the project. But I drew this in a cloud because nobody's that lucky, or not everybody is that lucky. How about that? A lot of times these are phone calls or side conversations. Your boss is just asking you verbally, can you do this project? So you're getting presented with the mandate however it is, if it's written down or verbally. But this will trigger you into Prince. And the first process we're going to use in Prince is called starting up a project. But this is all being done in pre-project. We don't actually have a project yet. All we have is a project idea. And we need to suss out, before we do the project, just confirm, is this a good project idea? Because just because you have an idea doesn't guarantee you it's a good idea. And I'm talking about even ideas from the CEO, yeah? Not even every idea they have is a good idea. So we need this process to kind of weed out bad ideas and not pursue those. So we're just going to check this out. First thing we need in starting up a project is a couple of people. So not a whole bunch of people because we don't have a project yet, but we do need an executive. That's our senior manager who's going to be accountable for this project and our decision maker. And we need a project manager to manage the project, to start managing what's happening next. So a decision maker and a doer. We also need a couple informal logs. The first one is our daily log. We've been seeing this pop up here and there throughout the other videos. This is just our project manager's to-do list, notebook of events, or journal. I tend to have notebooks, like physical written down notebooks, because I like to write things down on paper. But you could use your phone, you know, something to just capture ideas and thoughts as you have them. Any follow-ups or questions you want to answer, you want to follow back up on, you want to write those down as you think them instead of making a mental note, because mental notes tend to disappear and you forget. So we want to make sure you have some way of capturing stuff. And it's really informal. It's just for you, daily log. In fact, I think Prince says something like, everyone should have a daily log, but we make the project manager have one. That's how important these things are. The next log we'll start is the lessons log. This is because we have a principle that says learn from experience. So we need a log to keep track of all the lessons we learn on this project. But actually, we're going to start in pre-project and learn from previous projects. We're not even waiting to we make our own mistakes. We're going to learn from previous mistakes. And I said mistakes, but I also mean and good things, because lessons can be both good and bad. So we'll go back and look at previous projects and see what they did well, so we can try and replicate those, and what they did poorly, so we can try and avoid those. So we already are starting lessons. These are the two logs. They're quite informal logs. The main output from this process is going to be the project brief. And I underlined brief because it is brief. This is not called project lengthy document for a reason, because it's very, very brief. Two sides A4. We're in pre-project right now, so we don't have a project, which means we don't have a project budget either. So if you're spending tons of time and effort on this project brief and it's a 50-page document, really second guess yourself. What on earth are you doing? And more importantly, who on earth is paying for this? Because there's no project budget. It's not coming out of that. This is just a brief that we do for free, and we briefly answer a few key questions. So why do we even want to do this? What would we be doing if we do this? Because we're not sure yet. We're not sure it's a good idea. How might we do this? And who might be on this project? So we'll briefly look at this to understand how big of an idea this is, and is it looking like it's a good idea? The last thing we do in this process is create a stage plan for stage one. Everybody's first stage is always going to be the initiation stage. So it's called an initiation stage plan. Remember, we always create a detailed stage plan for a stage right before that stage, because of that whole planning horizon concept. You don't know details too far in the future, so you can only plan details for the near term. So right before stage one, we'll create the stage plan for stage one. And if the board like the project brief, the very brief brief, then they're gonna have to fund the initiation stage where we can start working on details. But if they don't like the brief, we don't need to use this stage plan. So we need money if they want details. If they like the brief, then they need to start paying for this. So we're going to give this information to the board, and they're up there and directing a project, and they're going to make their first decision to authorize initiation. So if they like the brief, they have to pay for stage one. The thing is, if you get a no decision here, this is a fantastic result. I promise you this is a fantastic result. You will not be pursuing a known bad idea. If you can think back on all the projects you've done in your career, and you know those ones that you knew before you even started this thing that it was a bad idea and you pursued it anyway, those are called skeletons in your closet. Yeah, what a horrible, colossal waste of time and effort. So here we are, we've got this nice decision point to weed out bad ideas. And if they don't like it, then they'll more than likely gonna tell you, go on to the next mandate, the next idea, and see if that one's any good. And you might be looping around here a couple times until you find that one that they're like, yeah, that's the one. That's the one we wanna see more about. And so they authorize initiation. Once you get that go ahead, project manager is gonna start working on the PID. PID is the project initiation documentation. It's not a document anymore. They changed it to documentation. In fact, it's 12 sections. It's in the book in Appendix A on page 320. So if you have that, it has these 12 documents. It's a document set about the details. So here we are. Now we're not going to rely on brief information. We want detailed answers before we do this project, what exactly are we going to be doing? How exactly are we going to be doing it? How much time and money exactly is going to be involved in this? Where will this all happen? Are we doing it in-house or involving external suppliers? What level of quality must we meet? Remember those measurable acceptance criteria. And who exactly, in which roles, is going to be doing all this work? And then we justify it at the end. Why are we doing this? Is this justified to do all this work on this project? So we have this massive PID. I mean, it doesn't have to be massive depending on the size of your project, but we do need these details about the project in the PID. Once we understand all that, let me go back real quick, because to get all these details, this is not just the project manager coming up with stuff out of their head. This is after a series of workshops and consultations and conversations with stakeholders, the project board members, the users. You're having tons of meetings to clarify all this information. Then our project manager is responsible for typing up the documentation. But they're not coming up with this on their own. So they're not never at any point in time doing stuff on their own. Always people are helping them out. All right, with the PID, we want three formal registers. We need a risk register to help us track and manage risks as we go through the project. We need an issue register to help us track and manage issues as we go through the project. And we need a quality register to help us track and manage all those quality tests. Remember, every single product that we create in prints has to pass a test. And we want to keep track of all those tests in this quality register, proving that every product is passing the test. Every product is a good product. And if you're not familiar with the term quality register, maybe you've heard of test plan, because that's what a lot of companies call this. So if that makes more sense to you. All right, we finished with this document set, but we're not done with the initiation stage. We're approaching our first stage boundary. So we have a process called managing a stage boundary. Every time we get towards the end of a stage, we need to start getting ready for the next stage. So we're at the end of stage one. We need to get ready for stage two. We'll put the detailed stage plan for stage two together. And again, we're now up against this stage, so we know those details of the near term. So we have a detailed stage plan. And then we've now finished with the stage, so we can write an end stage report telling the project board, we are finished with this stage, we're ready for the next one. And now we have to go back to the project board. At the end of the initiation stage, the board actually have to take two decisions. It's the only time they have to do two decisions at once. The first one is to authorize the project, and that's based off the PID. Do they like all those details? They saw this project idea before in a brief, but it was two sides of A4, and it was very, very brief, and it looked promising. Now we're showing them the details. Do you still like this? It's like when you go look at a car or something, you're trying to buy a car, and on the outside it looks wonderful, and you're like, yeah, this looks really great. But then as soon as you open the bonnet, you see the details, you're like, that is not what I thought this was. You slam it down, walk away from the deal. Same thing could happen here. And that's actually another good result. If the board now see this in detail and they don't like it, then let's cut our losses and run. Yeah, we don't have to pursue this. We spent a little bit of time here, but not an inordinate amount of time. And let's definitely not pursue something we don't even believe in. But we're going to say they like it. They love the PID. But they also have to make a second decision. We have a principle called manage by stages. So the board will never pay for the whole project at once. They'll only pay for a stage at a time. So we're going to, we've shown them the stage plan for stage two. They have to authorize the stage plan. So they're looking at that. Do we want to pay for stage two? And then they'll see you at the end of stage three to pay for stage three, or sorry, see you at the end of stage two to pay for stage three, see you at the end of stage three to pay for stage four. So this is how we'll keep meeting back with the project board. They said yes, and so we're into stage two. Our project manager uses a process called controlling a stage. They're just gonna follow that stage plan and start authorizing work packages down to team managers. If you don't use this term work packages, all it really means is instructions to do some work. So we authorize work packages or instructions down to team managers. Team managers are in a process called managing product delivery. Remember, these team managers, they're our specialists. So we're going to ask them to do some specialist work for us. Now they have to agree to do this work. Yeah, so we give them some instructions. They have to agree to all these instructions. We call that accept a work package. Once they've agreed to do it, they have to do it. We call that execute a work package. And when they're done with all this work, it's not theirs to keep. They have to give it back to the project, and we call this deliver the work package. Especially if you're working with external suppliers. I just paid you a whole bunch of money to create these products. Those products are mine. You need to give them back to me. So they have to deliver them back. And this is how we're going to get specialist work done. So our project manager is just delegating the work packages based on the stage plan that they put together and that the board approved. So everybody knows the order and how we're doing this and what we're doing, the resources we're using. So this isn't a surprise. Meanwhile, as this is all going on, our project manager has to keep the project board in the loop about how they're doing, and they'll send highlight reports during the project to keep them involved, because they don't have to be involved on a day-to-day basis. That's not what they're there for. So just to keep them in the loop, we send them highlight reports. They are available if we need them for any ad hoc direction, but they're not involved in the day-to-day management. When we start getting towards the end of stage two, we said it's time to get ready for the next stage. So every time we're approaching a stage boundary, we've got to manage the stage boundary. So we're finishing up stage two, we're planning stage three, our detailed stage plan for stage three. But this time we've got a bit more work to do in this process. We also need to go back to the project plan and update it. So we go back to the PID, pull out the project plan and update it to version two of this thing. Because we want to keep an accurate history of the project as we go. So we'll keep track of all the actuals that we've just finished with stage two and any new and improved predictions or estimates for the rest of the project. Sometimes just finishing one stage, you get a really good sense of how fast or slow this is going to go. And you get better estimates. You get better and better at your estimates. So we update the project plan. Next is to update the business case, because we have that principle, continued business justification. It's not just project justification at the beginning. We have to keep digging this thing up and updating. What does it look like today? 6 months later, does this still make sense to keep investing in this? Is this still a viable project idea? So have an updated business case. And then the last thing, write that end stage report. Confirm to the board we're finished with this stage and we're ready for the next one. And then we have to go back to the board and they're going to have to authorize the stage plan. We're showing them a stage plan, so they have to authorize us to move forward. Now this is what we call a go, no-go decision. So go, obviously you can move forward and keep going, use that stage plan, but they might say no-go, stop this project. Maybe new priorities have popped up in the organization and they'd rather spend their money on something else. So no go, stop this project and close it down. And maybe next year we can pick this back up again, but it's not what we want right now. And I bet you a lot of projects currently with COVID-19 have stopped just for that simple reason. We'd rather make payroll at the moment than spend our money on this project. When everything calms down, we'll come back to it, but close this down for now. So these are go, no-go decisions. And it's not necessarily because your project's bad, it's just the timing's wrong or the priorities are wrong. So here they're gonna say go, and we're gonna see how this gets really repetitive. Our project manager's back into controlling stage, delegating work to a team manager. Team manager's working on the work, but as we saw yesterday, if a team manager predicts or forecasts to go outside of work package tolerance, they have to raise an issue. So our project manager captures this issue in the issue register, does the analysis, and realizes this is inside stage tolerance. So just like with anything that's inside stage tolerance, the project manager can make the decision about what to do with this. So we call this takes corrective action. So they fix whatever the problem is, team manager keeps on going. The next work package, the next team manager walks into work and they can predict or forecast to be outside work package tolerance, so they raise an issue to the project manager. This time our project manager captures it in the issue register, does all the analysis and realizes this is outside stage level tolerance, so the project manager has to escalate this. This is bigger than the project manager, so they send an exception report to the board. Now the board weren't anticipating having to make a decision today. Yeah, they weren't planning to meet with the project manager until the end of the stage, but all of a sudden this exception situation happens, so they have to come back to this project and make a decision. They actually have three choices with this. The first one is they could fix the problem. Yeah, they senior managers tend to have some magic tools available to them. If you're having any problems with suppliers, you just get some senior manager with a C in their title to make a phone call, and all of a sudden, problems tend to disappear. It really is magic. So maybe they can pull some strings for you. They could close the project. Again, this exception situation is so massive, it doesn't make the project work anymore. This is too big. Let's just stop the project. Or their third option is to request an exception plan. This is a replacement plan. So currently your plan is not working. Thus you have an exception. Something's gone horribly wrong and they're going to ask you to replan it, create an exception plan. So our project manager will then have to move into managing a stage boundary process, because this is where we do our detailed planning. But instead of a stage plan, they're going to create the exception plan that was just asked for. But there's going to be some knock-on effects. Let's say, for example, that this exception is going to add 3 extra months to this project just to take care of this exception. So we create the exception plan and show the project board that this is going to be, you know, quite massive to recover. But then the project plan is out of date. I have to add these 3 months onto the overall project plan to reflect we're adding 3 months to the project. Have to update the business case. By adding 3 months of time and cost, did that just take the business case out of balance? Are the benefits still worth more than the time and cost of doing this project? Is this still a viable project? And then an end stage report. This one's a little awkward because you're not really at the end of the stage, but we do need to have an understanding, how far did we get into the stage before we hit this exception situation? So we write an end stage report. We finished what we could and everything else is waiting to move ahead. We now have to show this exception plan to the project board. And this is still a go, no-go decision. Even though they asked for this stage plan, or sorry, this exception plan, we created it, still can't use it until we're authorized to use it. And the board might look at it and say, ooh, we didn't realize that's 3 extra months. We don't like this. So stop the project. No go. Or they could say go and we keep on going. The 3 months is worth it. Let's keep going. So our project manager is back into this controlling stage. So just like before, in fact, it looks identical. But something I want to point out is that this is not stage 4. We're still in stage 3. We're just finishing out stage 3 using an exception plan, or what I like to call a replacement plan. So we still are working in stage 3, finishing out the work using our replacement plan, delegating work to team managers, reporting highlights up to the project board. And now when we get to the end of this exception plan, it means it's time to get ready for stage 4. So we're back into managing a stage boundary. So now we really are at the end of the real end of stage 3, time to get ready for stage 4. Same old things, detailed stage plan for stage 4, update the project plan with actuals to date and any new predictions for the future, update the business case to make sure this is still viable, and confirm to the board we are 100% now done with this stage and we're ready for the next one. And it's back to the board. So you see how repeatable this is. It's nice and consistent. You know, you don't have to make it up on the fly. It's nice and consistent. Back to the board. Is this still a go, no go decision? I know we're so close to the end, but they might say no go. Something else has come up. Some new priority has come up and we're going to stop this project and revert or avert resources to something else. So this is still within their realm to close this down, even we're so close to the end. Here they're going to say, keep going. So we've got our final stage. Now, this is my final stage in my example, simply because I'm running out of room. Yeah, you could have 50 stages on your project. So stage 4 is not everybody's final stage. It just happens to be mine because I was literally running out of room and I couldn't keep on going. But it's the same repeatable stuff of how it gets work done. A project manager controls it by delegating work to team managers. Team managers are getting the work done, giving it back when they're done. Our project manager sends up highlight reports. The board are available for advice if needed. The difference with this final stage is when we get to the end. Because as you can see, at the end of every single other stage, we've been using managing a stage boundary to get ready for the next stage. if you're in your final stage, there is no next stage. So you can't use that process. So we'll just swap it out for closing a project. So that's the difference. The final stage just doesn't have managing a stage boundary. It's going to have closing a project. The final process and the final stage is different. So what are we doing here? We're going to get this project signed off and accepted. And it's all based on that measurable acceptance criteria we worked so hard for with the customer, figuring out what exactly do you want at the end of this project. And we made sure they told us measurable acceptance criteria. Well, we're here. We're at the end. So we should have met this. We finished everything they asked for. Everything's passed its tests. So we're done. Sign off here, please. We've met all those acceptance criteria. Now that it's signed off, we're handed over. And we're talking about the specialist products. So all the specialist products, your new IT system, you can hand it over to the users, or your marketing campaign, you can hand it over to the marketing team. They are your users. Whatever you've created, you're handing it off to the users. Your management products, all the documents that you've been creating to help you manage this project, those are going to be archived because we're almost done managing this project, so we don't need those anymore. Specialist products, though, go to users. All except for one management product, because that benefits management approach that went hand in hand with the business case. We said in the business case had a list of all our benefits, but then we had a separate document, benefits management approach, that said, what are all the benefits that should result from this project? What dates should those be reviewed, and what are the step-by-step instructions to review them? Here we are at the end of the project. These benefits are going to be coming in after the project, so we're going to hand over this document to the senior user so they know exactly what to look for, they know exactly when to do this all, and they have these step-by-step instructions to follow to do it. So no excuses. So we hand that over to the senior user who's going to be responsible for benefit reviews. All right, after that, we can do an end project report. So at the end of every stage, we've been doing an end stage report. Now we're at the end of the project. We just summarize the whole thing. How did the whole project go? And inside of this end project report is the lessons report, because we want to be able to share all the lessons we've learned on this project with other project managers. So don't just keep them for yourself. We want everybody to learn what we did well so they can replicate it, and what we did poorly so they can avoid those. And then the last thing our project manager does is draft a closure notification telling all the stakeholders that this project is over. The thing is, it's not over. It's not over until the board says it's over. So that final decision at the end of closing a project, the project board have to come in and say, yes, this truly is over. And then they will send out the closure notification to all the stakeholders so that it comes from a senior manager telling everybody this project is officially over. So if Susan comes around asking for resources for a project, has nothing to do with this one is over. And the team then disbands and they go on to other projects or back to their business as usual functions. The team disbands and nothing left for the project team to do anymore except for one role. We said those benefit reviews still have to happen. So it's going to be the senior user who's going to do those benefit reviews. So maybe 6 months after we go live, they can go measure, did we get that increase in productivity we were looking for? A year after we go live, they can see, did we get that financial savings we were looking for? They have to go and do those benefit reviews, but those are happening post-project. So hopefully they are happening, but project manager is not around to ensure that because they're long gone. They've disbanded with everybody else. And that was the process model. So well done for sticking through that. I know that's a long one. I now want to just show you some variations on this. So how to tailor all of these 7 processes. If you're working on a small, simple project, all of that was a lot of effort. You don't have to do so much. You could have just 2 stages. So we still have the starting up, the pre-project, is this a good idea? But then you have a really small initiation stage, so maybe 2 or 3 days worth of work to get the details sorted. And then the rest of your project, stage 2, is your final stage. So you get all the specialist work done with your team managers, and then at the end of that stage, you're into closing a project. So really quite simple. Minimum stages are 2. Everybody has to do that initiation stage and then the rest of the project. If you're part of a program, this is some good news. You just have to focus on your project. They are going to do all your pre-project work for you and your post-project work. So starting up a project, they've already done, because they've already decided what 30 projects do we want to do on this program. So they've already thought through what are good ideas for projects. So they've done that for you. And then as far as the benefit reviews go, there's a role on the program board called Business Change Manager, who's responsible for measuring all the benefits from the entire program. So you're part of the program, they'll do your benefits reviews. So you don't need to do anything. As a senior users doesn't need to do those, at least. So good news, you just need to concentrate on your project. Another tailoring aspect might be to combine starting up and initiating. Sometimes it's appropriate to combine these things, especially if you're super confident you're going to do this project. So it's not a matter of, is this a good idea? You know you're going to do it. I'll use GDPR as an example. The fines for being non-compliant with GDPR are astronomical. So every company in Europe is saying, we're definitely doing this project. It's not a matter of, should we do it? So they're definitely doing it. They then combined starting up a project and initiation just to figure out how are they going to do it and the extent of it, extent of the project that they need to do in order to be compliant. So that was appropriate in that situation. So it depends on your confidence level with that. If you're not sure you're going to do the project, then maybe you split them up just to sense check the idea before you get involved. If you're super confident, go ahead and combine these two. And then last one, using different processes. We're showing you here 7 processes to use on a Prince II project. But if you do not like these, then you do not have to use them. So that's good. However, you must have a consistent set of processes to follow to take you from the beginning of the project to the end. And you'll have to document what are these other processes that are different than Prince. And you'll document that in your tailoring section of the PID. How did we tailor this? We chose to use a different set of processes. And that's it, the process model. Hopefully you liked that, seeing this in action from beginning to end, putting all this stuff together. I'm going to take it out of sharing screen, and we can go to questions about all of this. So let's see, chat. Oh, what is GDPR? Oh, sorry, this is, what does it stand for? Does anybody know what the official, it's a European-wide standard of how people deal with personal data. I cannot remember for the life of me what the GDPR stands for. But it's things like your personal data. If you're a company collecting personal data like names, addresses, emails, you have to prove that you're doing it securely and you're only using it for certain purposes and you destroy it when you're done. And if you're non-compliant, the fees are astronomical. Ah, thank you, whoever is putting that up there. General Data Protection Regulation. Thanks for that. So the fees are astronomical. I mean, like millions or 17% of your profits, whichever is larger. So it was absolutely worth it for companies to be compliant with that. All right, any other questions? Yeah, so hopefully you've enjoyed these. Yeah, it's been a really great focus for me. So I appreciate you coming on board. And unless there's any questions, we're done. So thank you.